Hi Leo.
Hi, hello Dan.
Hi everyone, welcome to Poetology. This week is an interview with Leo Bois, whose first full collection in English, Ballad of a Happy Immigrant, came out last year. In this conversation, we discuss Leo's poetry collection, bilingualism, being an immigrant, and being queer. I hope you enjoy this interview, and I will see you on the other side.
Thank you so much for coming to this interview.
Yeah, thank you so much for inviting me. It's an honor. I'm really excited to be talking, you know, with you. And it's great.
Yeah, same. So today we're going to talk mainly about your recent collection, Ballad of a Happy Immigrant. Let's get started straight away. So my first question is, what draws the speaker out of his country of origin?
It's a really interesting question. I mean, those themes are very much present in my book and in my work generally. You know, I'm a bilingual writer and I write both in Spanish and English. And you know, this book, I began writing this book quite a while ago. So some of those poems about me coming from Argentina into the UK, you know, that kind of movement from one place to the other, whether, you know, those themes were there from the very beginning. And so in a way, you know, when I was putting together the collection, I realized that there were those kind of key elements that I should, put in the collection, that there should be, you know, at the heart of the collection, this idea, because it's so much part of who I am and my practice and my work. It's this idea of like, you know, being from other place and coming to the UK and that experience sort of being very much part of the collection in many different ways. I was looking at this diasporic sort of experience from many different angles, and I feel that my work and especially this book it really taps into this kind of intersectional or intersectionality sort of aspect that I'm really keen on, like sort of looking at all these different layers that are part of who I am as a person, as a poet, you know, a migrant, a queer poet, a bilingual poet. So all these different aspects, very much so, like sort of, you know, bringing that from my experience as an immigrant as well.
And that's a fairly common trope for queer writers, right, of leaving your family of origin behind and moving somewhere else. It happens a lot.
I think so. I think it's really interesting because now looking back, I think that was one of the main reasons I left Argentina. So I felt oppressed. I felt that I there wasn't a space for me there. I mean, things have changed hugely in Argentina. And the Argentina that I left is not the same. Obviously, you know, many things happened and many things sort of changed since then. But personally, you know, my family background, my story, my near sort of group of people, I felt that it wasn't that place for me somehow. And yeah, it's interesting. Now looking back at, you know, the reasons why I left Argentina, you know, that was one of the reasons. And it's true that, you know, especially from perhaps poets or writers from my generation, there is that kind of common thing going on. Perhaps not so much with younger queer poets that perhaps are experiencing a different reality, mostly because there's more information around, not only for, you know, for us, but for our parents, and they perhaps know more, they're more open, they're more, they understand more. So, yes, I think sort of things change quite a bit. But there are things that, you know, I really do feel that I'm part of that kind of community, that collective of queer LGBT plus poets, and then we do have lots of things in common, although, you know, perhaps generationally, you know, and even like with older poets, you know, I've been translating the work of Diana Bellesi, who's a you know, the godmother of sort of lesbian poetry in Argentina, and she's, nearly 80. And it was just fascinating to kind of work with her poetry. And just, you know, she came to the UK and we toured, you know, in the UK, and just, you know, thinking about that generational difference and different experiences, and yet so many things in common, so many things that sort of unite us. So yeah, it's great.
Your collection also contains bilingual poems, or at least there are lines in Spanish, and it contains translations, sometimes mistranslations. How do you find the process of writing in English as a second language, especially as someone who, as you said, works in translation too?
It's a really important aspect of my work. And you know, when I came to the UK, I always say this, when I came to the UK, I couldn't speak a word of English. I couldn't write very much in English. And so I was writing poetry in Spanish, and I was very content and very happy with that. But I realized that I was living in a sort of, in a bubble somehow. I was just reading, writing for a certain groups of people, like perhaps like migrants that couldn't speak English, or writing for people in Argentina or in South America. And so in a way, writing it in English was a sort of, it was a step towards talking with my friends, my new friends, my new life here, so my new people here in the UK. But it was, you know, it's not an easy process. Some writers still refuse to write in another language, you know, apart from the mother tongue. And I thought, why not? You know, it's just it's quite a rebellious thing to do. It's almost like people would say, oh, you shouldn't be doing this. You know, you should write in your own, in your mother tongue. And I was like, well, why not? You know, what happens if I do it? And even translating, you know, I don't translate from Spanish into English. That should be what you expect from someone, you know, coming from Latin America. I translate from Latin America, from Spanish into English. Mm-hmm. And again, I have people saying, you shouldn't be doing this, you know, and I love that kind of slightly going against the kind of the what people expect. And also, like, I live here, I work in this language right now, you know, I'm part of this, you know, place and language and culture. So I feel like sort of it makes sense for me to kind of say something in English, whatever I have to say. And even, you know, always say, you know, even though perhaps I don't know all the words in English that an English native speaker would know, but with the ones I know, I could do something with them. I can play with them. I can sort of explore and experiment, and that's why I use Spanish in my English, and that's one of the reasons I'm so interested in translation, because I feel like conceptually it's such a fascinating thing. Like I feel like I always, coming from another culture and another language, I'm constantly translating. I'm translating ideas, I'm translating, you know, words, I'm translating concepts. I'm, you know, from one language to the other all the time. I'm perhaps talking with someone in Argentina and explaining something that happened here, and I'm trying to translate culturally. You know what I mean? It's almost like a process that is an ongoing thing. And in a way, in a larger, you know, we I think we all translate all the time. We all sort of, from one language to the other, from one culture to another. I mean, it's a really fascinating process. And the mistranslation thing is a sort of response to that idea of the perfect translation. Because I always felt that I was failing. I would never get the perfect translation. And I thought, what if I try to mistranslate? What if I try to write my own version of that poem? Or, you know, the mistranslation is all about, you know, that sort of thing that happened when you try to communicate something and perhaps you get 90%, but you're missing something like a 10%. Mm-hmm. Or perhaps you don't get anything from that. So, you know what I mean? That mistranslation happens again all the time. That you think that you know what that person said or meant, and perhaps you literally mistranslated that experience. And And again, you know, going back to the experience of kind of being a foreigner or a migrant or an outsider, you know, this idea that you misrepresent or people misrepresent you or mistranslate you, and how do we sort of translate each other's sort of culturally and in many other aspects. So in a way I'm interested in translation and mistranslations, but I think what I'm really interested is in the conceptual idea behind it.
People often ask me if I write in French. They're always asking me, so do you also write in French? And I don't. And they're a bit shocked or surprised that I'm not writing in French. Why am I not writing in French? It's my mother tongue. But in a strange way, I just kind of switched to English and I don't really write in French anymore. And people find this very strange. But when I try writing in French, it almost seems less natural just because I'm not thinking in French as much. It could come back, you know, maybe, but yeah.
In my case, I'm writing definitely more in English, but you know, because I published this collection and I'm working towards a second collection in English, and I published two collections in Spanish, and at the moment I don't have a project to write, you know, anything in Spanish. But when I get commissions or when they ask me to write poems for an anthology, I love that. It's almost like it triggers that sort of, okay, I can write in Spanish, I can do this. It's more like when immediately the natural thing now is to write in English, because I feel like, okay, I can show it to that person, or I can send it to that magazine, or I can do something with this. And Spanish, I feel like it enters into this kind of realm of, it gets, you know, quite in suspense until someone sometime kind of, you know, looks at the, you know, the poem. But it's a really interesting thing. I wish I could be like more, you know, writing like equally in both languages, but I guess from my own experience it is really hard. Like normally you concentrate on one language and the other you do less. It's almost like you know, sometimes I try to translate poems that I wrote in English into Spanish just to see what happens, and what would happen is that I rewrite that poem, because while I'm translating it into Spanish, I would add things. I would, you know, why not? I mean, I wrote that poem, so why not sort of changing it as I go along? So it's a really good way of like writing new stuff. Going to my because it's, I wrote both things. So why not going back to my English poems and perhaps play around language and write in Spanish some of those poems.
I also love seeing the different landscapes of both Argentina and then London and Kent interwoven throughout the collection. Can you talk about how these different landscapes and environments inform your writing?
I love nature. I'm an outsider. I'm outside to the person. I write in my garden. I'm surrounded by plants and birds and I did the same in Argentina. I very much enjoy the countryside and nature in general. So for me, landscape and especially like nature is a very important thing. I connect to those things sort of quite deeply. So I could write a poem, I don't know, about a bird from the perspective of that bird, and sort of perhaps humanize that experience, you know, from that. And so the nature is a really good sort of starting point to write about a place or an experience. So there are poems in the collection where I talk about, you know, looking at nature, perhaps, you know, looking at a climber plant or the bird, and thinking that experience reminds me of something that happened in Argentina, or, you know, in terms of the weather as well, or, you know, those things, seasons. I'm just fascinated because I spend a lot of time looking at plants and birds and nature. I'm a member of the Royal Society for the Protection of Birds here in the UK, and I love birds, and I spend a lot of time just looking at the things, and some birds are the same, you know, we have the same birds in Argentina, and some are completely different, and it's for me, it really comes naturally, this idea of landscape and nature and the natural world, and kind of how it informs my writing, and the different temporal spaces and places that, you know, I inhabited. It's very important in my work.
Ballad also made me reflect on how to make a home in a new place. And then there's always that question of the return. Is the return possible or even desirable?
In my case, it's more sort of an ideal place in my mind or in my writing than an actual reality. My partner is here in the UK. We've been together for over 20 years, and I live here in Deal and a little bit in London, and my life is here. But you know, there's this pull, linguistically and also emotionally. Somehow, I lost both my parents in Argentina, so that kind of link, perhaps, was sort of, it's not as strong as it used to be. But obviously, I go back. You know, when I write, I'm writing a series of sonnets at the moment, Latin American sonnets, where I sort of write about Latin America in general, but sort of Argentina in specifically, and also like my relationship with the continent and Latin Americans and anything Latin American. So it's a way of looking at those places and the culture, but from here. And so it's going back to that place, but conceptually, I would say, in the poetry, in my writing. And it's a great source of ideas, you know, just memory in general. I go back to experiences or memories. I find and I discover things that I completely forgot, and that those things are like sort of great sources for just writing new poems or it's a really interesting question. It's almost like, why would you, perhaps, you know, my second or third collection won't be about Argentina, won't be about Latin America. It will be about something else, completely different. And perhaps the fact that this was my first English collection, I think there's this element of, you know, a sort of calling card, like, you know, this is who I am, this is where I'm from, these are my interests. It's all there, and then perhaps I'll go into like some some other idea or theme, you know, hopefully, you know, in the future, but there's always something that comes back, like sort of bilingualism, language translation, bicultural sort of experiences, you know, the whole queer experience as well. So yeah, there are elements that will come back, I'm sure.
In the UK, there are quite strong bilingual, immigrant, and also queer poetry communities, and they seem to be developing quite a bit. What has been your experience of navigating the poetry scene as a gay Latinx?
Well, I've been very much involved in that community for a number of years. I've been sort of nurturing young Latinx writers. We've been part of various collectives where we worked and mentored young Latinx writers, some of them queer, but not necessarily. And so I've been involved in those collectives. I was part of a collective of Spanish and Latin American writers when I sort of, I don't know, 15 years ago. So, you know, finding that community was very, very important for me. And then, you know, that community changed slightly because, you know, I was part of the Complete Works program. So the community extended to perhaps poets from, BME backgrounds, for Black and Asian, and when would mean Latinx as well. But always finding that kind of community, that space where you feel safe, you feel that you have things in common. And Jarana is another space that I always feel, you know, connection with because of, you know, poets that write in another language, and in English, but coming from another sort of culture and language. And so there is always, you know, those communities and those spaces that I think are very important. And yes, for me, those were key. I mean, I have to say that without them, I wouldn't be here. I wouldn't be who I am. Although it's true, I write in isolation. I write on my own. I'm not part of like workshops, for instance. I do run workshops, but I'm not part of like workshops. Perhaps, I don't know, because I do a lot of activism, and I work with so many groups that when I write in isolation. I write sort of on my own, but. Yes, I don't know if I answer your question, but communities are very important for me, and I think I'm still part of those communities. Yeah.
Can you read a poem of your choice?
Yes, of course. I thought I'd read Ballad of Happy Immigrant, but mostly because it encapsulates many themes from my we talked about today, and I tend to read it quite often. I think it's because there's this kind of musicality of the poem, and I like this poem very much. It's the title poem, Ballad of a Happy Immigrant. In the beginning, there was a garden and a boy who counted ants, dug for bulbs. All this he enjoyed. Come back a man or never come. Father greased the Peugeot, his blasting radio of 80s techno on. Learn, one day you need to know. Come back a man or never come. The spaniel dog under the kitchen table, the endless heat, the dusty sparrows on hanging cables. Come back a man or never come. Mother's palm leaf dresses, her sandals. The day she left, they took her things. I lit a candle. Come back a man or never come. Father dressed younger and then remarried after loved sweet wife who quickly buried. Come back a man or never come. We moved two times. From south to north, some things we took, some we forgot. Come back a man or never come. My sisters shared a fuchsia room, their ploys. I found a corner where I hid my joys. Come back a man or never come. I went on trains to school and back. At home, the fights burn stakes, news cracks. Come back a man or never come. The night I left, I gave some clues. Look out for me, my ties, my shoes. Come back a man or never come. The shared old flat in Knaresborough Court, six a room, a kitchenette, my home of sorts. Come back a man or never come. My lousy English searched out for words, though found I still could communicate with birds. Come back a man or never come. I met very few men, went out to clubs. Some were smarter than others. And one night at the NFT, I met the artist. Come back a man. Or never come. The daily trips to Hampstead Heath, late coffees in Soho, we kissed in Russell Square, a builder shouted, you too, homos. Come back, man, or never come. We moved together by the flower market, our tiny flat on Columbia Road, a new life had started. Come back, a man. Or never come. Long distance phone calls, dad and his orchids, his health, his lungs, the chats, more morbid. come back, a man will never come. I nurse him a week, his bloody coughs, and he died as my London flight to cough. Come back, a man will never come. By the sea we found some peace, you drew till late, I planted dwarf trees. Come back, a man will never come. Now I swim and swim, come sun or hail, the sea my friend, my foe, this holy grail. Come back, a man will never come. And if they ask, is this your home? I say, well, yes, at least, I hope.
Thank you, this was great. Where did this line come from, come back a man or never come?
That was the first thing I had. I knew that line. I knew that that was going to be the refrain in the poem. I knew that I had to write that poem. I wrote it in one sitting very quickly. I knew that the story and I knew that line. It was just so, you know, in the poem, the more I say it, it brings a different meaning, and it kind of builds up, and you know, it's almost this repetition that's sort of, it's almost like an incantation, and I think in a way it was something that somehow my dad said to me, perhaps not exactly in those words, but it kind of came back to me, and I just had to write that poem immediately, and in a way, yeah, encapsulates so many of my themes and my stories, almost like my autobiography in lines, and it's a song. I just see it, that's why it's a ballad. I see this kind of musicality. There's this full rhyme in the poem, it's still very dear to me. Although I read it many times, you know, in festivals and stuff, I feel quite sort of emotional every time I read it. It's almost like I invested a lot in that poem, it's quite dear to me.
Thank you for sharing it. Thank you very much for the entire interview. It was really great to talk to you.
Thank you so much, and it was great talking to you, I wish you all the best.
I will post a link to Leo's collection in the description below, and also a link to Why I Write Poetry, where Leo also has a chapter on writing in two languages. I hope you liked this video. Please consider subscribing if you enjoy what I do, and I will see you again very soon. Bye!